Thanks everyone for coming. My name is Khalil Shram, and I'm a postdoc at the Simons Institute, but I was a grad student here in the CS department, and I work in theoretical computer science. And thanks a lot, Harry, for inviting me to speak and kick this off. So, since I'm the first speaker in the series, I thought it would be really good to spend a lot of time kind of building a shared vocabulary, and I think if you're an expert in the subject, you're going to be really bored. But if you're not an expert in the subject, or even if you're like a medium expert in the subject and I say something that's unclear, please stop me. And also, I think there's a lot of cultural divides that have to be bridged, and so I tried to sort of focus on explaining what the culture around graphs is like in my field. So hopefully that is something that gets conveyed in this talk. So let's start really, really basic. So what is a graph? Many of you might know it as a network, but basically a graph is a collection of nodes or vertices. Okay, so these are points, and then we represent the relationships between them with these edges or lines. So a line between two nodes or vertices means that there's some kind of relationship between them. And then we can also have edge weights or weights that represent the strength of the relationship between the nodes. Okay, so graphs are everywhere. So I don't have to tell you guys this, like I'm mansplaining to you all about graphs, but let me just run through it because it is the introduction to talk about graphs. So, you know, we can represent social networks where the people are the nodes and the edges mean that the people know each other. We can have protein-protein interaction networks, which I don't really understand, but I think that it means that you have two proteins that interact with each other. If you know they interact with each other, you add an edge. Road networks is something that we're all familiar with, where the cities are the nodes and rows between them are edges. The internet, where the routers are the nodes and connections between routers are the edges. Okay, and one of the really, really great things is that there's a lot of power in using this abstraction, right? So we have an object, it's a map. But if we represent a map as a graph, suddenly we have access to a toolkit of generic algorithms that can work for any graph, right? So, for example, if I want to know what the fastest way is to drive between Berkeley and San Mateo, that corresponds to the shortest path between two nodes in a graph, right? I just take the road network graph, and the node is one node is Berkeley, another node is San Mateo, and then I ask, you know, what's the length of the path? Okay, same thing with if I want to know how close I am to Barack Obama in the social network, right? Like, if I want to try to make friends with him and influence politics in the past. So that's, again, the shortest path between two nodes problem. If I want to know how many routers will see the packets when I Google myself, so, okay, we can split hairs about how the internet works, but roughly that's like asking about the shortest path between two nodes. Right? And so really this is what one of the things that graphs are really, really good for. They let us use these generic tools to answer questions that arise in many, many different domains. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about what graphs are like where I'm from, which is theoretical computer science. So in theoretical computer science, we have an algorithmic perspective, right? We have a graph. It's completely generic. We usually don't assume that we know anything about it. And we have some algorithmic question that we want to solve, right? Like we want to find the shortest path between two nodes, or we want to find the way to cut the graph into two pieces where we cut the minimum number of edges. We want to find, the largest clique in a graph, meaning the largest subset of nodes that are all connected to each other, etc. And so, first of all, we want to design algorithms for these problems, but sometimes there are not efficient algorithms for such problems. And in that case, we want to understand why there aren't any efficient algorithms. Okay, so it's a question about classifying what we can and cannot efficiently compute about graphs. And then there's also a little bit of the mathematician's perspective that leaks in, right? Where really what graphs are is there a different kind of geometry, right? So, like, I think everyone is really familiar with Euclidean geometry, and, there's a lot of different generalizations of different spaces that you can work with. And what we want to understand is in graphs, which are kind of their own sort of mathematical objects, what geometric facts can we prove? Right, so that's like a little bit big right now, but maybe a little bit later it'll make a bit more sense. Okay, and this is, I mean, just a couple of examples from my research. I don't really want to explain what each of these are, just sort of to, like, overwhelm you by showing you how important graphs are in theoretical computer science. So just a couple of things that I've thought about in the past are clustering algorithms, both in the case when you assume your input graph is arbitrary or when you assume that it has some structure, computing quantities in graphs when you have a non-standard model, so you assume that you're given some other information. So that's from the algorithm design side. Okay, and then more from the complexity side, from the classification side, I've had some work where I try to show that even if you have a random graph, many algorithms fail to find the largest leak, which is a problem we think is hard. And also, I've worked a little bit in understanding the spectral or geometric properties of random graphs. Okay, so this is just a subset of things, and I think that this is reasonably, I mean, it's a small slice of what graphs mean to us in theoretical computer science. So, okay, but today I'm going to focus on graph clustering, and I'm not actually going to talk about any of my own work. So what I wanted to do is I wanted to talk about clustering because I think that's a question that many people have across many different domains, and tell you a little bit about how theorists approach it and how practitioners have come up with heuristic algorithms for clustering and how sort of those two communities have married to create a nice theory around graph clustering. Okay. So what is graph clustering? So I have some graph, and I want to ask how the nodes should be grouped together in a way that makes sense. Okay, so we'll become a little bit more formal later. But, you know, I have this graph. One way that, like, a general or guideline for clustering is that I want to partition the graph into chunks, right? So that each chunk kind of represents a community structure or, like, a related group of things. And that basically means that I want a reasonable number of edges inside the clusters and very few edges crossing the clusters. Okay, so, all right, so that's all fine and well. Like, you know, it's a cluster, like, I know it when I see it, right? So let me give some examples. Again, I'm totally probably preaching to the choir, but let me just give some examples. So in a protein-protein interaction network, you can identify clusters, and I took this directly out of a textbook. So clusters can suggest possible functions for members of the cluster, which were previously uncharacterized, right? So if you have proteins and you don't really know what their functions are, if you find a clustering of the protein-protein interaction network, maybe for other proteins that you do know that are in the cluster, you can now know what the proteins do in the metabolic pathway. And this is what happens when you Google protein-protein interaction clustering in PubMed, right? You get a lot of hits, and there are papers that ask how one should go about clustering to get good results, and also many papers that apply clustering to questions that arise. Okay, social networks. So there, a cluster might represent a social circle or a social group, right? And again, this is something that is helpful if you want to try to sell stuff to people, or maybe if you want to do some testing on a small subset of the graph, like your Facebook or something, you want to introduce a new feature to a group that won't spread too much. And again, if you look in Google Scholar and you Google clustering social networks, you get papers both talking about how to cluster and also many that apply clustering to a variety of research questions. Okay, and then, you know, maybe you have some other reasons for graph clustering. Like, maybe you, like, really want to look deep into your friend circle and understand, you know, what the group dynamics are of your Facebook neighborhood. Or maybe you want to spend a lot of time on WikiGalaxy, which is this awesome thing where you go online and someone has taken all the Wikipedia articles and kind of clustered them into this nebula of articles. So I hadn't really spent a lot of time here before preparing for this talk, but if you haven't been there, I really encourage you to go because it's really great. Okay, so the outline for the rest of the talk is kind of as follows. So first, I want to talk about formalizing graph clustering, which, if you're coming from a theoretical perspective, is really important. And if you're a practitioner, it's a little bit annoying because, you know, you know your cluster when you see it, right? So that's the first thing I want to talk about. Then I'm going to talk about one of the most popular algorithms for graph clustering in practice, at least as I understand it. And I'll talk a little bit about the theoretical reasons why it works. So some foundations. The first topic will be, or the first part will be the spectral embedding. So it's a way to take graphs, questions about graphs, and reduce them to questions about geometry. And then the second will be clustering graphs using the spectral embedding. Okay, so first topic is formalizing graph clustering. So what is it we want exactly? Right, so we want the best partition of a graph into k pieces, right? So maybe for this graph, it's like we can look at it and we can say, okay, it's pretty obvious that k should be 3, right? Like this should be a cluster, and this should be a cluster, and this should be a cluster. Okay, and what does that mean? Well, one thing it means is that we want to cut as few edges as possible. So what I mean when an edge is cut, it means one of its endpoints is in one cluster and another endpoint is in another cluster. Okay, so maybe our goal should be to minimize the number of edges cut. So we call this an objective function. Our goal will be to optimize this objective. And we'll want to prove, you know, mathematical facts about algorithms that attempt to minimize this objective. Okay, so is this a good objective for clustering? So for this graph, yeah, right? Like, if we want to split it into 3 pieces, such that we cut the minimum possible number of edges, it's pretty clear that we're going to get the best clustering from this, or the clustering we want. So we're happy. But the problem is that oftentimes you're going to have some kind of degenerate parts of your graph, right? So what if we add this little tail of 2 nodes? Well, now suddenly the best partition into 3 pieces is going to cut this edge and this edge, and we're going to get 2 lame clusters that only have 1 node in them, and 1 big cluster here where we didn't get any information about the part of the graph that we actually cared about, right? And so what that means is that this objective function is inappropriate for this clustering instance. Okay, so maybe we should try to come up with another objective function. So the thing that we didn't like about this objective function is that we had some clusters that only had 1 node in them, right? And that sort of didn't give us any information. So maybe what we should do is we should try to find the sparsest cut. Okay, so what's the sparsest cut? What we should do is we should minimize the number of edges that are cut, but then we should divide by the number of edges in each cluster, so the product of the number of edges in each cluster. Okay, so let's see what happens. So here, because in this cluster and in this cluster there are 0 edges, the cost becomes infinity. We divide by 0, we get infinity, right? So this would be a bad clustering under this objective function, and we've eliminated this kind of bad example, right? And this would be the optimal solution for this objective function. So we're happy. Okay, but it turns out that also for this example, we can come up with for this objective function, we can come up with degenerate examples that give us bad clusterings. So let's see what happens. So let's add these little heavy hairs onto the tail node. Right, so now what's going to happen? So this is the clustering that we want, right? And without belaboring this too much, the cost of this clustering with this objective function, so the value of this objective function, is going to be something like 10 to the negative 5, on the order of 10 to the negative 5. But now, actually, if we split these up, we get a product of, we get 1,000 squared in the denominator instead of just a factor of 2,000, right? So, okay, don't, like, spend too much time, trying to do the calculation in your head, but the cost of this clustering under the objective function is something like 10 to the negative 8. And since we're trying to minimize the objective function, to this objective function, this clustering looks way better, even though to us, again, it's not a very good clustering because we really wanted information about this bulk of the graph. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, the number of edges cut is the weight of the edges cut. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah, even for an unweighted graph, you could make examples where it's not the... Yeah, sure. Sure. Yeah, you just want to... I think that if you sort of appropriately... I mean, there's another thing going on here, right? Which is that if we changed our k instead of being 3 to being 5, right? We'd already be in better shape. So if you're flexible with your k, then I think you can't... maybe you can't get this good of examples, but I think there should be counterexamples even to this. And furthermore, for those of you who know what this means, this objective function is NP-hard to optimize anyway. So it's not like, you know, even if we could, even if it was a good objective function, we wouldn't be able to do very much with it. That's another issue. So this again was not completely successful. And maybe now we should try a completely different approach, right? So attempt three, maybe we should have similar nodes together and try to push dissimilar nodes apart, right? So what we're trying to minimize now, our objective function will be the number of edges cut, or the weight of edges cut, plus the number of non-edges not cut, right? So if two nodes don't have an edge between them, we want to push them apart. Okay, so here, if I take this clustering, it has cost 4, right? Because I cut these two edges, and I keep both of these non-edges in the same cluster. All right, so this seems good for this graph. But what if I have a graph that's like this, right? So this seems like a, I mean, again, we have two nodes that are in their own clusters, but let's ignore that issue for now. Right, this seems like a good clustering. It has cost 7. But now if I look at this clustering, which is not as good, right, because I sort of took this node, which obviously belongs in this part, and I put it aside, it still has cost 7, right? I'm cutting these 4 edges, and I leave these 3 in the same cluster. Okay, so again, you know, we're unhappy with this, and like, I guess what I'm trying to illustrate with all this is that, you know, there's this sort of tension between theory and practice, right? So for theorists, what we want to do is we want to prove really general guarantees. So we want you to be able to give us any graph, and we'd be able to say, yeah, you know, we're going to give you the best possible solution for this objective function for this graph. Okay, but for practice, what you really actually want is a good clustering, right? Like, you don't care if you manage to minimize some objective function if you've got clusters that give you information. And so I think often what happens is there's some mixture of theory plus some tweaking and intuition, right? So pre- and post-processing, and maybe using some heuristics that make sense, but you can't prove very much about, okay? And what you really get is in the case of graph clustering, there's been a really nice exchange between theory and practice, right? So practitioners are blazing the trail, and they see some heuristics and algorithms that work really well, and theorists sit around being like, you know, like, maybe there's something to that heuristic. Let me try to prove stuff about it. And you make assumptions about the graph that help you prove things. Okay, so that's I guess, what I have to say about formalizing the objective function for clustering. And I think that a really good example of this is a graph clustering algorithm, which is a combination of a spectral embedding plus k-means. And I think oftentimes people will refer to this just as spectral clustering, the combination of these two algorithms. So our strategy is going to be that we take some graph, we do a spectral embedding, so we embed it into some, into Euclidean space. Okay, and in Euclidean space, we're going to run the k-means clustering algorithm, and that will give us our cluster. So I'll talk about this step at length, and I'll talk about this step at length, and then I'll show you how awesome the steps are combined by doing some small examples. Okay, so I guess I'll start with the spectral embedding. So one issue is that, you know, so far I've shown you graphs that are really, really simple, where it's really easy to see the cluster structure, right? And I've drawn them in a way where it's nice to see the cluster structure. But usually, actually, what you get, you don't get a graph that looks like this, right? You get this list of numbers. Okay, and if you just get this list of numbers, it's not even clear, you know, how to draw the graph in a way where you can see the clusters, right? Like, this might have been your best attempt at drawing the graph. And so the question is, how should one do this? Like, how should one take a graph, which is represented as this list of numbers, and embed it into a real Euclidean space in a way that makes sense and will yield good clusters? Okay, so the way that we do this is with the spectral embedding. So for this part, I was going to switch to the whiteboard because I think it's really rude to just put a bunch of math up on slides. So let's do that. want to project the... So again, for this part, feel really, really free to slow me down or stop me as I'm going, because I'm worried that the, you know, the jargon, like, will just spill out of my mouth as I get excited about writing stuff down. Okay, so clustering, intuitively, we're given a graph on say, n vertices. Use this abbreviation, and what we want to do is we want to split it up into clusters, and that goal is sort of like, what do we want to do is we want to find a bunch of small balanced cuts, right? So we want to maybe cut it, you know, first like this into approximately half, right? And then we want to cut it again like this, and then each piece is going to be a cluster, right? So we want small So what does balance mean? Balance means that I want, you know, like, each side to have maybe at least 10 over 10 parts, vertices. Some constant fraction of the vertices. So this isn't always what we want, but in many cases, this is roughly what we want. Like, we only care about the sort of big clusters. Okay, so one way that we can get information about this is using a matrix representation of the graph, so the graph Laplacian. Graph Laplacian matrix is a matrix, so for any graph, I can write down this Laplacian matrix, and that will tell me a bunch of information about the cuts. Okay, so it encodes some information, so we'll see in a second what that means, but given G on n vertices, I can write down a matrix L sub G, the Laplacian of G. It's going to be some n by n matrix. And the rows and columns are going to be correspond to the vertices of the graph. Okay, right, so the jth vertex will have the jth row and the jth column. And the easiest way to define the Laplacian is to define it as a sum of edge Laplacians. So can people in the back see if I write down here? Okay, so I'll write LG as a sum over edges IJ. L sub ij, and then I'll define Lij to again be the n by n matrix. It has a 1 in the diagonal entries corresponding to ii and jj, and minus 1 in the off diagonal entries where they meet, and then 0 everywhere else. So 0, 0, 0. Okay. And so now, let's say that I have a cut vector x. So, a cut vector x, I'm going to say that it's a vector, an n-dimensional vector with entries that are either plus or minus 1. right? And the idea is that there's going to be the plus one side of the cut and the minus one side of the cut, right? So let's say I look at this cut. I'll assign every vertex on this side of the cut a plus one, and every vertex on this side of the cut a minus one, right? And so, like, maybe these parts of the graph are called A, B, C, and D, right? So this cut I would encode by saying X. Maybe there's the A, B, C, and D sections. So here I would have plus ones, here I have minus ones, here I have plus ones, and here I have minus ones. Okay, so this is the cut vector for this cut, yeah. Yes. Yeah, let me repeat that. So I'll define the Laplacian by taking a sum over all of the edges. Okay. For every edge, I write down the matrix ledger. So basically everywhere where there's a blank space, assume it's a zero, right? And I'll have a one for the nodes for the two endpoints. And I'll have a minus one for their intersection. So if I and J have an edge between them, I'll put a minus one there. Okay, and if there's a weight on the edge, if there's a weight W sub ij on the edge, I multiply the whole thing by W sub ij. So I have Wij on the diagonal and minus Wij off the diagonal. Okay? Yeah. No, sorry. It's an n by n matrix. It's an n by n matrix, but every entry that I didn't write down is zero. So there's zero on all the other diagonal entries, the off-diagonal entries, etc. Except everything but these four entries is zero. Yeah, so for directed edges, there is a notion of Laplacian, but directed Laplacians are not very nice to work with, and they don't have a lot of the nice geometric properties that undirected Laplacians do, so today this is only for undirected graphs. In a second, I'll write it down like this, but first, I want to say, like, why I would want to do this, right? This seems like a weird thing to write down initially, right? And the thing is that if I take X as a cut vector, right, so X is some cut vector, and I look at the quadratic form X transpose Lij X, right, what does this do? Well, this is just equal to Xi squared, because that will be this entry, right? Plus xj squared, because that's that entry. Okay, minus 2 times xixj. Okay, and if you stare at this for a second, you can realize that this factors really nicely, right? So this is just equal to xi minus xj squared. Okay? And now, if I and j are on the same side of the cut, like, if they're both assigned a plus one or a minus one, I'm going to get I'm just going to get zero, right? So zero if I, j on the same side. And if they're on different sides of the cut, I'll either get two or minus two squared, right? So I'll get a four. So now, if I take the quadratic form of a cut vector with the Laplacian, by linearity, that's like the sum of the quadratic forms of the individual edges, right? And that's just going to be 4 times the number of edges of G cuts by X. And so for this reason, the Laplacian matrix is super nice, right? Because it encodes cut information in these quadratic forms. Yeah. No, they are. The A and C are plus one, and B and D are negative one. Okay, sorry, yeah. I mean, it's very likely that I'm going to mess up something like this, so please be on me. Okay. To get some embedding of the graph that is reasonable, but that's in the later we'll see that that's exactly what we're going to do. So we're going to recursively apply this kind of cutting thing. Yeah. So maybe for now it's easier to think of things that have symmetry, like that are really symmetric, where it's a series of balanced cuts. Good question. So can I erase the edge Laplacian? Are you guys going to remember? I mean, the only property of it that we really care about is that we have these squares. Okay, maybe before I erase it, let's make one more observation. So, here's an observation. This quantity is always going to be non-negative, right? So, if I take a real vector x, or a cut vector x, why is that? It's because this is just a sum of squares, right? So a sum of squares of real numbers, I can never get something negative. So it's at least zero always. Okay, that's the only place we're going to use the definition of the... Okay, maybe one more thing. So if I take x to be equal to the all ones vector, right, then maybe let's have it be v1. So let me define v1 to be the all ones vector. Okay, so v1 transpose LG v1 is just equal to 0. So if I take the quadratic form with v1, I get 0. Okay, so why is that? So if every entry has the same value, I'm just going to get a sum of zeros, right? I mean, that's equivalent to every vertex being on the same side of the cut, and that means that no edges are cut, right? So... Okay, so those are the only two places where we'll use this structure. So now what we want is we want a balanced cut, right? So what does that mean? So say that we want a cut where we have exactly half of the vectors on the left-hand side of the cut and exactly half of the vectors on the right-hand side of the cut. Okay, so that means that we want x that's a sine vector, has entries plus or minus 1, and having half plus 1, half minus 1 means that we want the sum of the entries of x to be equal to 0, right? Because half of them are going to be plus 1, half of them are going to be minus 1. Assume n is even. And this is equivalent to just saying that x be orthogonal to the all ones vector. Because this is just the dot product of x with the all ones vector. So now what we want really is we want to find the smallest cut possible, right? So the smallest balanced cut possible. So we want the minimum of this quadratic form with a Laplacian under the constraints that x is a sine vector and also x is perpendicular to the all ones vector. Okay? And if we can find this, then we would at least have a way to know, right, like what we want to do is we want to plot the graph on some axis, right? So this is the positive part of the axis, the negative part of the axis is the origin. We would know to put all of the nodes on the plus side here and all of the nodes on the minus side there, at the very least. Or vice versa. But this problem is not possible to compute efficiently, probably. So again, it's NP-hard. I'll say a little bit more about NP-hardness later. Yeah. No. Yes. Yes. That is true. Humor me for a second, and then I'll explain why it's not a problem in a moment. Yeah. dimensional embedding, okay, an embedding into the line, right? So, and this is the origin. So what I could do is I could take x, and I could say that if, so for every node I, if xi is less than 0, I'm going to put I over here, right? And if I, or xi is greater than or equal to 0, I'll put I over here, so j, I guess. Okay, this will give me like a really, really, you know, rudimentary embedding into space. But you can see that maybe if we recurse this a couple of times, right, we'll be able to get a better and better idea of what things would look like, right? So here, for example, you know, in the first step, we'll know that A and C should be on one side, and B and D should be on the other side. That's in one dimension. But if we're willing to take a two-dimensional embedding, then the next cut that we'll have is already this one, right? And then we'll have each one in its own quadrant, and that will basically be exactly our clustering. Like, right, from that we'll be able to look at the embedding and say, oh, that's exactly the clustering we wanted. Right, so this version puts it just in points with 1 or negative 1. But now in a second we'll, actually just right now we'll see that we don't have to, that's not what we're going to do in the end. Okay. Yeah. Or in general I just want a geometric representation of the graph where points that should be clustered together, nodes that should be clustered together, correspond to points that are close by to each other. That will be important because of the next algorithm that we're going to use to actually obtain the clustering after we do the embedding. Okay, good questions. Okay, so this quadratic form, this objective function, I mean, over this domain, I guess, will give us an exact cut, right? It will classify everything to either exactly plus 1 or minus 1. But this is hard to compute, right? It's hard to compute this quantity. So, like, in general, things where we, like, really enforce that things be discrete are hard to compute, and that there are many exceptions, but in this case, this is not an exception. But the thing is that we don't really care that it be discrete, right? This is a totally artificial thing. Like, we're fine with any embedding that makes sense. So what we're going to do is we're going to relax this objective function. Or we'll relax the domain. So instead what we'll do is we'll ask for the minimum x transpose LGX. And now we'll have the constraint that x be, let's say, a unit vector. So in Rn, right? So I'm allowing it to have real entries, but they don't have to be plus or minus 1. They can be anywhere between, you know, minus 1 and 1. But I just have a norm constraint, right? I say the norm can't be too large. And I'm still going to have the constraint that x be perpendicular to the all ones vector, because otherwise I'm just going to get the trivial solution of all ones. Okay, and I'll solve for this. And now instead of having all of my nodes either being at plus 1 or minus 1, I'm going to have them all kind of in between, right? I put I at xi. That's my one-dimensional embedding. Okay? And the really good news is that this quantity is easy to compute, right? So this is the second eigenvector. Of the Laplacian. So can I get like a show of hands of who loves eigenvectors? All right, good. A lot of people love eigenvectors. Me too. But I'll just remind you what an eigenvector is in case it's been a while. So if I have A, let's say it's a real symmetric matrix. Right, so that means that if I take the matrix, all of its entries are real numbers, and if I look at the ijth entry, it's equal to the jith entry. Right, so V in Rn is an eigenvector if AV is equal to lambda V, where lambda is also some real number. right? So these are the vectors that get mapped to themselves when you apply the matrix to them, or multiply them by the matrix. It's not difficult to prove that these vectors are exactly the same as the minimizers here. So the second eigenvector, the vector with the second smallest eigenvalue, will be the answer to this problem. Right? That will be like what I'll call V2. And then V3 will be the minimizer of the same thing. But I also add the condition that I be perpendicular to the second eigenvector. Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, right? You're familiar, you've worked a lot with eigenvectors, actually, you don't know it if you've done principal components analysis. Right, so what's principal components analysis? Principal components analysis just asks for the maximum eigenvalue eigenvectors. PCA, you're actually looking at max over y of norm 1. Y transpose A, Y, where A is your matrix of data. Yeah. Yeah, so, all right, first of all, notice already that the all ones vector we know is a degenerate eigenvector, right? And it's possible that you're saying, you know, there are several eigenvalues that are the same. Let me tell you one case in which that's true, right? So say that my graph is actually just two disconnected components, okay? Then in this case, really I could have treated, you know, I could just look at the eigenvectors on this part and the eigenvectors on this part separately, and I'll have two copies of sort of the zero vector corresponding to having only ones here and only ones there. Okay, so that's already an example. So this example does come up, but we can always get rid of it by looking at each component by itself, because we can separate the components of the graph in polynomial time. And then for the other kind, if you add a random perturbation to the edges, so like every edge you perturb by plus or minus some tiny, tiny number, that will, with probability 1, basically, get rid of any degeneracy. So we don't really worry about that too much, but that's a good question. Okay, so let's see, where were we? Right, so this is exactly going to be our strategy. We're just going to compute, our algorithm for the spectral embedding is going to be as follows. Okay, so D-dimensional spectral embedding we compute the eigenvectors V2 through VD plus 1, right, because we skip V1, so and we want to get D of them. Okay, and then we just have a N by D matrix whose columns are the VIs, right? And now, if we want to embed the jth point in D-dimensional space, what we're just going to do is we're going to go to the jth row of this, and those are going to be the coordinates for that point in D-dimensional space, right? So here we did this already in one dimension. If we did this in two dimensions, right, we would look at if we want to look at the jth point, we'll have j be at the point v sub 2, j, v sub 3, j. And in the slides, I have some examples where I've done this. Okay. All right, so one other thing is that, you know, this quantity isn't exactly the minimum balance cut, like we said, and sometimes we don't even want it to be. But the fact that we relax things and let them have values between plus and minus 1 instead of having them be stripped, that saves us. So, like, if we have a graph where here there's a cut that has maybe size 2/3, or sorry, a component that has size 2/3 n, and a smaller component that has 1/3 n size, right? What X would do is it would just have larger values here and smaller values here and still be orthogonal to the Alpha Spectre. So all of those kinds of issues go away. And I'm not going to make the connection between these things formal. I'm just going to tell you that you can make it formal. And maybe not in the strongest way that you'd like, but there are two, maybe, like, the most canonical papers, depending on your community. So there's a paper by Eng and Jordan and Weiss from 2001. These are Berkeley people. And there's also a paper more recently by Lee of Weiss-Garon. Trevisan from 2012, and they sort of formalize what you can get from doing this higher order spectral embedding, like how good the clusters are going to be if you do this. Okay, so that's the spectral embedding. Are there any questions about that before I? So at this point, what we've done is we've taken a graph and we've mapped it into d-dimensional space in a way such that nodes that should be clustered together are likely to be close to each other in this embedding. Okay, yeah. It is equivalent to, if you're in the case when the graph is completely regular, meaning every vertex has the same degree, then it is equivalent to that. But otherwise, it's not equivalent to that. And the reason is because, okay, maybe we should take it offline, but I'm happy to answer that question later. But they're very, very related concepts. Yeah. You do. So, I mean, like, you tell me what you want D to be, and then you have to compute that many eigenvectors. Fuzzy sets are, so. But we should discuss it. Okay, so can I turn the projector back on somehow? Okay, so for the rest of the talk, this will just be a black box. Like, we'll assume that we have computed some spectral embeddings. But now I want to show you some spectral embeddings of actual graphs, because I don't know, like, for me, I guess I'm right, I'm a nerd, but like, the first time I saw this, it made me really excited. Like, it was during my first year, and that's why I went into this area. So maybe saying that, like, you'll see it and be unimpressed. I should have undersold it, but. Okay. All right, so let's see the spectral embedding in action. So say that my graph is this 6x6 grid. Okay, so this is my graph. So now let's see what happens when I do the two-dimensional spectral embedding. So this is what happens, right? And you can totally see that it's exactly the grid. And this isn't like, you know, I mean, I didn't run the code in front of you, so maybe you don't believe me. But you can see that, right, like another thing that you can see is that kind of the points get closer together as you get near the boundary, right? Somehow that's because, like, you can also make this formal, that if you think of this as a spring mass system, this will be the kind of resting configuration of the system. So you can really see how the points near the middle, where there are more springs, are kind of pulled further apart. The points near the boundary are closer together. Also, what happens if we delete this edge between 15 and 16? Again, you'll see the springs kind of on 15 and 16 pulling them further apart. So this is, I don't know, I think this is super great. Like, what happens if we delete all of these four edges, you know? Wow. Right? I don't know. I mean, this just illustrates that it's not true for every graph, that if you look at the two-dimensional spectral embedding, you'll get something that makes sense. But I think the grid is a really, really striking example where that is indeed the case. And many things which actually, like graphs that actually correspond to something that you can draw nicely by hand will give you this effect. Okay, oh yeah, let's see our favorite graph from the intro slide. So this is the three-dimensional spectral embedding for this. So even here, you can see that like the way that it got embedded makes a lot of sense, right? If I look at this kind of cluster that corresponds here, you can see that 5 is much closer to 6 than any of the other vertices. You can see that 3, 4, and 5 are kind of in this triangle. I mean, I sort of had to rotate in a specific way, but you can see that 3, 4, and 5 are kind of equally close together, and then 1, 2, and 3, because they have this kind of triangle structure, they're closer together. So, I don't know, I mean, now what we want to do is we want an algorithm that can look at this embedding and can find clusters from it, because we as humans definitely can do it, right? Oh, sorry, 11 and 12 got mapped exactly on top of each other. So, I mean, and that really makes sense because 11 and 12 are sort of, to every other node in the graph, they're basically equivalent, right? Like, you know, like, they're equal distance from 10 and from 7 and 8 and stuff. So in the spectral embedding, they just got mapped literally to exactly the same point. They're not distinguished in the low degree spectral embedding. Or sorry, low dimension. Okay, so the algorithm that we're going to use to go from the embedding to an actual clustering is k-means clustering. And probably many of you have used k-means, maybe completely as a black box. So I'm just going to open the black box a little bit. I'm not going to prove anything, but I think k-means is a really good example of where algorithms that practitioners use kind of trickled into theory, and theorists tried to start proving things about k-means clustering. Okay, so what is the setting for k-means clustering? So we have some set S of n points in space. You can just think of Euclidean space. And what we want to do is we want to choose a set C of k centers, so just points in space, that minimize the sum of squared distances. So here, the points that I chose were these stars, right? And I'm going to minimize the sum over the whole space of the distance between every point to the closest center squared. So this is going to be our objective function. Minimize the choice of centers, minimize this quantity, the sum over all of the points of the distance squared to the closest center. Okay? And then the clusters are determined by the centers, right? So everything that's mapped to the same center goes in a cluster together in the end. Okay, so this is a really old, I mean, not really old, but it's a reasonably old idea. It goes back to the late 50s. And an algorithm for this problem was also proposed then. It's a heuristic, so we don't know that it converges always, but we have some good ideas about when it does converge, and it seems to work really well in practice. But it turns out that we can't actually get what we want, because I'm throwing this term around the talk, but finding the optimal set of centers is NP-hard. So what does that mean? This is a pretty, it's like kind of a technical condition, but actually it's equivalent to this. So if we had an algorithm that would exactly solve the k-means problem efficiently, that would mean that we had an algorithm that would solve many problems that we know to be pretty hard too efficiently. Meaning, like, I can take any hard problem, not any hard problem, but many hard problems, and I can just encode them as a clustering instance. Okay, and then if I had an algorithm that perfectly solved the k-means clustering problem, even when k is small, I would get an algorithm for the hard problem, which I shouldn't have an efficient algorithm for. Okay, so that's too bad. You know, theorists maybe would like throw up their hands and quit. But there are k-means algorithms that work really well in practice. So there's the original k-means algorithm back from the 50s. And then there's an update to it, k-means plus plus, which is a way to initialize the algorithm that works really well. And sort of inspired by this, we know that there are k-means algorithms that work okay in theory, right? So if you give me the most general possible clustering instance, then I can give you a algorithm that gets a 2.611 approximation. So what does that mean? It means that the value of my objective function will be at most a factor of 2.611 larger. Yeah. So it is exponential. So, okay, I don't want to get into it, so find me offline, but, you know, some problems you can approximate arbitrarily well, as you take, like, if you're willing to take more time, so, like, NASDAQ is an example of this. This is not one of those problems. It gets hard. Yeah.
Okay, but now the thing is that, you know, noticing how well the K-means algorithms work in practice, theorists have said, okay, well, what if we're willing to make a bunch of additional assumptions about my instance so that it's actually something that we would want to cluster, right? So there are K-means algorithms that work really well, in theory, if we compromise. So, for example, if K is small and the number of dimensions is small, okay? Or if we use 10 K-centers instead of only using K-centers. So we'll end up with, you know, 10 K-clusters, but in the end, maybe we can piece together those clusters to get something that makes sense. Or maybe if we know how some of the points should be clustered. So if I'm allowed to ask, say, k-squared queries of does this vertex belong in the same cluster as this other vertex, then I can get arbitrarily close to the optimal solution. So remember that what we wanted to do is we fix some value of k in advance, and in the end we're going to get k centers. So, but now say that I say, okay, well, really I wanted to have k clusters, but I'm willing to compromise and run the algorithm with 10k instead of k. So the objective value, if I run it with 10k, will be comparable to the objective value if I only ran it with k. Yes, there are 10k clusters. Yes, the center still defines the cluster. So then we humans have to do some post-processing. Right, we have to do some post-processing and look at the clusters that came out and say, okay, well, like, you know, it looks to me like this cluster should go with that one. Good question, yeah. Okay, yeah, so I think this is a nice, like, success story of the marriage between theory and practice, yeah. Yeah, that can't get you as good a... I mean, right, like, you won't be able to bootstrap that into something optimal, but heuristically you could probably do that, and maybe it will work out fine. I mean, the truth is that, you know, if you run K-means clustering, it's going to give you, in many cases, a pretty good solution anyway, right? So this is all, like, theorists, I mean, it's not all theorists trying to prove stuff, given what we know works well in practice, but there is a little bit of that going on, right? Yeah. I guess you wouldn't arbitrarily put them together, right? So you would have to do some kind of, repair afterwards.
So I got K-means clusters, and I just know sort of from my domain knowledge, like,
yes.
These should go together.
Exactly.
There's different places for that strategy.
So maybe we should talk afterwards, because I only, right, all the papers that I know are really theoretical. I don't know of any paper in practice that has done something like this, where they've taken more than the number of clusters that are desired. Yeah, you should talk, yeah. So the difference is that here it's not okay to just have a random subset of them. You have to be able to ask queries, right? So I have to be able to say, I want to go out and find out exactly what the classification is for I and J. And once I know that, I can get a really good algorithm. But oftentimes when you're working with classifiers, you just happen to have some random subsample of the data. So. But maybe sometimes you could apply these algorithms. Okay. All right. So I guess I'm pretty close to the end of the talk, but so maybe I'll skip the K-means plus algorithm, or should I do it anyway? Okay, I'll do it anyway. Okay. So how does K-means plus work? So what we do is we choose a random point from the data set and we put it in our set of centers, right? And now, as long as I don't have enough centers, so I want to have k centers in the end, I'm going to add a random point from my data set to my set of centers with probability proportional to the squared distance between my point and the center. So right now, like, here, this is the distance between this guy and this center. It's much more likely that I had a point from this subset than from either of these, right? So I'll sort of end up with a point that's far away. That's, like, going to be a new, different center from the ones I've already seen. Okay, so say I ended up adding this one. So now the closest center to some of the points may have changed, right? So it's very unlikely it'll add any of these points. And I recurse until I have k centers. And now one could just return this clustering, okay, but actually we never do this, right? So what we do is we use this as an initialization to the k-means algorithm, which is going to be a local search method where we try to improve this clustering. Okay, so now we're going to use the original k-means algorithm. So we initialize our set of clusters with the k-means plus plus centroids. We then make the clusters out of them, and then for each cluster we compute the centroid of the cluster. So that just means the geometric, or just the average of the points. So I just take the sum of all the points and I divide by the number of points in the cluster. Okay, and then I compute these new centers. And then I make this equal to my new set of centers. And then I would recurse. So here, I mean, I drew this example. Actually, the clusters didn't change at all. So once the clusters stop changing, the algorithm converges. Okay, but I just do this over and over again until the algorithm converges. And we don't know much about the convergence guarantees for this algorithm in the general case, but in some specific cases, it's known to converge. Like if the clusters are very separated from each other to begin with. So if it's really obvious what the clustering should be, this will work. Okay, and that's it. That's the k-means algorithm. So that's spectral clustering, right? We start with a graph, we take the Laplacian, we compute its top eigenvectors, or its smallest eigenvectors, we write down the spectral embedding, and then we perform k-means clustering on the spectral embedding, and we get our clusters. And you know, this is like a really canonical algorithm, right? So I guess this is a Jared package. Or it's your package. No, there are a lot of people involved with this package. And you know, here, like, k-means is clustering case. These are the top clustering methods in this package. And k-means is number one, so you totally already know what that is. But this spectral clustering method uses exactly this combination of algorithms, right? So this is canon. For MATLAB, there's also a package that does this, and other ones too, but I was a little bit hesitant to include them because I'm not, like, a real practitioner, so I didn't want to offend anyone by, like, putting down a ludicrous, you know, software package, so, but, you know, maybe you know of a different package that also has this method. Okay, so now let's see it in action for some of the graphs that we saw. So we'll combine the spectral embedding with k-means, right? So if we run it on this graph, we're going to get, I ran it like three times. Twice I got exactly this clustering. So this is basically what I would think would be the correct clustering for this case. You know, sometimes it puts out something that makes a little bit less sense, like this clustering, right? But still, you know, the nodes that end up together in the cluster are close to each other in the original graph. So that's good. So you can see that it's really like an algorithm that does make sense. And for example, friend graph, this is what the k-means clustering returns. So these are the centroids, and we end up clustered like this. Yeah. You mean Euclidean and then k-means? Yeah. So the work that I mentioned here, the Leo Weisbaron and Trevisan paper, doesn't use k-means as the second step. So this is a clustering paper, and they do something really like that you would only do in theory for the second step. I think this paper actually does do k-means for the second step, but they make some assumptions about the graph that are a little bit less. The Leo Weisbaron Trevisan paper doesn't make any assumptions, so, you know, for theorists, that's like
really great. Yeah, you're right. They are like disconnected. I mean, K means you don't have to run on a spectral embedding. Also, you can run it on any data set. Okay, so that's that more or less concludes the talk. I wanted to, you know, write down the concluding remarks. So graph clustering is ubiquitous. I think everyone already knew that coming in. It's important to formulate the correct objective, and I think this leads to some tension between theory and practice, but, you know, hopefully we can still find a way to get along. And the spectral embedding is totally awesome. Next month, Nikhil Srivastava is going to come, and he's going to talk a lot more about the spectral properties of the Laplacian, so a lot more about the eigenvalues of Laplacian and what that sort of means for graphs, and how to get sparser representations of graphs that are faithful in terms of the Laplacian embedding. So that's a really exciting topic of research, and hopefully what I've said today will help for next time. And the K-means algorithm, I think, is a nice case study of the, you know, interplay between theoreticians and practitioners and how both sides inform each other. So yeah, so thanks so much for your attention. You've been really great. Not that I didn't know of. Yeah, so one thing that people definitely do is they perform normalization on the Laplacian matrix. So here's one case in which this really helps. So say that you have a graph. It's pretty sparse, but there's one node that has really, really high degree compared to everyone else, right? So what you want to do is you want to really penalize that node, because otherwise all the information is going to be about that node, right? And that node is actually just only one node, right? So one thing you do is you just divide that node's row and column by its degree, maybe. So, or for every row and column, like for every node, you just divide the row and column by the degree. And that is actually exactly a bending of the space. And then you do the Laplacian embedding. So that kind of thing is done. And I think there are other things that are done, like maybe you take the, you know, the X of every entry of your matrix in the beginning, and then you, so for 0-1 matrices, it's not that exciting, but for weighted matrices, it can be. So first of all, I have very little intuition for when deep learning works and doesn't work, but I would suppose that you can't generalize information from small graphs to big graphs, right? And I think that most of the graphs that people care about are really big these days, right? Because there's like a lot of data. So I think that, I mean, all of the mappings that I know are based on this kind of spectral information, but sometimes you would do some pre or post processing to the matrix to get rid of the distances. I mean, the reason that this, you know, like, I don't think I'll be able to say anything satisfying formally and briefly, but the reason that this really works, in the cases when it works, is because graphs that participate in different, or sorry, nodes that participate in different sets really also are on the opposite sides of many cuts in the graph. And if you're on the opposite sides of many cuts in the graph, that means that you're going to be far apart in the eigenvectors, and therefore also far apart in the spectral embedding. But, you know, there are counterexamples to this. And for, in those cases, the spectral embedding may not work very well, right? So the guarantees that are given in these papers are in terms of properties of the graphs themselves, right? So, like if you have something that just isn't clusterable, like the complete graph, this isn't going to do you any good, yeah. Yes. Right, so K-means plus plus is an algorithm. It's not right, so it's kind of confusing. But K-means is both the name of an algorithm and the name of a problem. The K-means problem is NP-hard. The K-means algorithm is, I mean, the K-means plus plus is just an algorithm. It's not a problem in addition to that.